Mesdames, messieurs, je dois commencer pour et dire que je suis très honoré d'être avec vous, mais je dois m'excuser que je ne parle pas le français très bien parce que je n'ai pas d'exercice dans le Parlement flamand. Et dans ma période dans le Parlement fédéral, j'ai beaucoup plus d'exercice pour parler français. Maintenant, c'est un peu dur pour moi. Et pour ce raison ça, je vais parler anglais. And I want to start by saying that I feel a little bit ashamed because in Ljubljana I really didn't recognize Christian de Frenje, but because it was a little bit out of context, and at a certain moment somebody said hello to me and I didn't recognize her immediately, so I have to apologize again, but I am at this moment a great fan of her, so I think that will be okay. I have to speak about the city of Mechelen. I'm mayor in Mechelen since 2001, and you asked me to tell what happened there, the transformation of the city in, let's say, 20 years. I think the most important thing to keep in mind is not that it's such a successful city without problems. We have our problems and challenges like every city, but maybe the remarkable thing was the total makeover, I could say, of the city in 20 years' time. It was a city that changed enormously in a very short period. So it's a little bit a story of hope and optimism. Let's start by situating Mechelen. It's a city of nearly 90,000 inhabitants. It became, like a lot of cities in Western Europe, very multicultural. Nearly 32% of the people living in Mechelen have a migrant background, and one out of two kids born in Mechelen have also a migrant background. The most important, let's say, group of newcomers is people coming from Morocco. Second group are the Assyrian Turks, that are Christian Turks, people coming from Turkey with a Christian belief. And then the third group are Armenians. We are the most Armenian city of Flanders, the second most Moroccan, and the most Assyrian of all Flanders, to give you an idea. So we are a very diverse city with a lot of people with a foreign background, in total 138 nationalities. If you go back 20 years, as the next slide, you would see that, the next slide, please. Yeah. You would see that these are a few articles of Mechelen during the 90s. At that time, Mechelen had a very, very bad reputation. And also the actual situation at that moment was very negative. It had the highest criminality rate of all cities in Flanders. It was, by Testankoop, which is a consumer magazine, stated that Mechelen was the filthiest city of Flanders. Extreme right at that moment was by far the biggest party in my town. We measure in Flanders also between cities the proudness. Are you proud of being a citizen of Mechelen or Ghent or Antwerp or whatever? That proudness was the lowest in my town. People are not proud of being citizen of Mechelen because it was a city of misery, of problems, of insecurity, of a negative feeling about integration. It was a dirty city with a lot of poverty. So it was sitting in a negative spiral. And the only thing we had was a great past. Once we were the capital of the Low Countries, we had a lot of monuments, but they were not well kept at that moment. So people look back to the past, that in the past it was better. Today we live in a city of misery. That was the general feeling. With, for example, Vlaams Belang, that gained a lot of votes out of that situation, and they gained in the early 2000s, I think, nearly 30% of the votes, and they were by far the biggest party. And in that context, people longed to have a new approach. They voted me as a young mayor. My party was always a small party in the city. But they did it not because they believed very strongly in my political, let's say, party, but they wanted to have a real change. And the only alternative for me with a lot of young people was extreme right. So we got a chance to take the city in control. And these are articles of today, 20 years later. That shows the little bit the difference. In 20 years, Mechelen became one of the most, let's say, livable cities of Flanders. And friend and enemy acknowledge the enormous change and also in the atmosphere in the city. These are articles from the last, let's say, 3-4 years. It are articles, and one of the let's say the most important or the highlights was indeed that we gained the prize of best mayor, and that not a prize for me, but a prize for the whole of Mechelen. It's not for a mayor, it's for the city. But we won it, and we get to compete with cities as Vienna, Rotterdam, and the cities before us who won the prize, where cities like Mexico City, Cape Town, never in the history of that prize, a small town as Mechelen gained the prize. So, am I the only one who hears a baby crying?
Yes. Pouvez-vous couper le micro, s'il vous plaît? Je pense que...
That's not Mechelen, you know. That's somewhere else. What do I do? I go on?
Oui, vous pouvez continuer. On va, Joël va se reconnecter. Je ne peux malheureusement pas... je n'ai malheureusement pas la main sur le son des autres participants. C'est Joël qui a la main.
OK. So, maybe I show you the next slide to give you a concrete example how important the change was. I give you the criminality figures of the police, and here you see a comparison between 2019 and 2002. 2002 was the first year we measured criminality in a very objective way. And then you see the difference in the city. It's that's a very important element in creating another atmosphere in town. People felt very insecure 20 years ago. Today, people feel safe in Mechelen. And it's also because you see car theft, for example, minus 90%, violence with weapons, minus 92%, violence with death with violence, minus 82%, burglary, minus 75%. That makes a complete different city after 20 years. Second element I like to show you, that's the next slide, that's from the what we call the Stadsmonitor. It's the benchmark the Flemish government every 2 years make of the 13 most important cities of Flanders. And they make a benchmark about hundreds of things. How many parks do you have? How many people are born in poverty in your city? How many social housing do you have? How many car thefts do you have? How high is the average income? And so on, and so on, and so on. How many houses are isolated? So they measure it. It's a big book, a benchmark to compare cities. And to give you this example, because they also measure proudness, for example, of the feel. Do you feel good in your town? And this is the measurement of, are you proud of being a citizen of those cities? And in 2000, Mechelen was the lowest. And if you look now, in 2018, we. Hello, do you still hear me?
Yes, on a eu juste un petit problème, c'est réglé maintenant. Vous pouvez continuer, okay. Désolé.
Okay, so if you see this is a graphic showing how proud people are, and proudness is a very important, let's say, indicator of feeling good with yourself and with your environment and with the other persons in town. And in 2000, it was the lowest. Today, in 2018, you see Mechelen has the highest ranking, is the number one in feeling okay. And it's not only for that, but if you see in that same city barometer, you see and you ask the question, how clean is the city? We are the cleanest of Flanders. How is your attitude against people with another cultural background? It is the highest now. It was the lowest 20 years ago. It's not now middle, it's not the middle, it's the highest by far. Child poverty, it was the highest, we had the highest child poverty rate of Flanders, even higher than big cities as Antwerp and Ghent. Today we are in the top three of the lowest cities with the lowest rate of child poverty. And I can go on with a lot of indicators. Even Minister Homans, who was the interior minister responsible for the barometer, had to admit that that Mechelen was a city that was at that moment, let's say, the top of the 13 cities in Flanders. So it's a complete turnover in only 20 years. And the question is, how did we do it? And I have to be honest now, it was not a plan we had we had with us when we started as a mayor. It's a process of trial and error, it's a growing thing. We made a lot of mistakes, we did some things good. And now if I look back and I reconstruct what we have done, you could say there were three pillars that made the success of what we tried to do in Mechelen. And the first pillar has to do with security, feeling secure, and the rule of law. That's something, and you will see that in every pillar, we try to work out of the box. You will not find classical answers. It's always a very strange combination. If you look to the ideological, in an ideological way to policies, you will not understand it, because you will see some elements are very left-wing, others are maybe considered right-wing, and often it's a combination of those that made the success. It was really out-of-the-box thinking, how can we solve the problem of our city, because I was born and raised in it, I saw the decline, I wanted to make a difference together with my team, and we wanted to try to find a new way, a new approach in finding answers and creating a new future for Mechelen. And the first pillar is the rule of law, and for us it was a social policy. Because our input was that the first victims of a city where there is no rule of law are not people living in middle-class neighborhoods. Because those neighborhoods, you don't see gangs there, you don't see drug dealers at the corner of the street. You find those people often in the more vulnerable parts of the city, the poorer parts of the city. So if you have a city where there is no rule of law, then you have only the rule of the jungle. And the first victims are the weakest persons in your town, the most vulnerable. The poor people living in vulnerable neighborhoods are often the victims of a city where there is not enough security for everybody. So we try to make it clear that our policy of creating a more secure city was in fact a very social policy. And we did it in two ways. First of all, we invested very clearly in police, also in police cameras, but not only in that. We tried to create new systems of how police could get the law respected by everybody. For example, I give you three small examples. First of all, we created a system that when a minor did something wrong, something not really severe wrong, but did things that were not okay. For example, breaking down something from other persons, or whatever minors can do wrong. We brought them to the police station, and we also invited the parents. It was a kind of a project we had, and those parents they had to sign a contract together with the minor and the police in the city. That they, for a few months, they had to do something together. Try to bring the minors back on the right track with involvement of the parents. And the city helped them to realize that approach. And we won, and that's already a long time ago, I think 15 years ago, the prize of the best prevention project of Belgium with that approach. Another thing we did was dedicated the policemen to the, let's say, the top 20 of what we call in Dutch draaideur delinquenten. Those criminals, those people who were in criminality, who came before court, then were punished, and 3 weeks later they did it again, and the police took them again, and always they were walking in circles between the police station, the court of law, sometimes the prison, and then back society. So we say we have to do it differently because that doesn't help anything. So what we did, we dedicated a policeman to the top 10 or top 20 of those people who created the most problems. And it was a kind of uncle. It was very strict to them, but also was trying to create new opportunities together with social workers. How can he find a job? How can he restore the relation with his parents? How can he create a better environment for himself? So it was a kind of carrot and stick approach to those people. And a last example, at a certain moment, we discovered that there was not enough place in closed youth detention centers to not to punish, but to readjust young people. And what we did there was we financed ourselves as a city a new not a youth prison but a youth detention center, because the federal government said at a certain moment we cannot we don't have the money to finance it. And I thought it was so important that we offered to the at the federal government that we would pay it for them, at one condition, that it was used in primarily for youngsters out of Mechelen who need that structural approach. So that was the, let's say, the more repressive side. But if you go one slide back, we didn't own, So police is only one thing, because you cannot create a secure city or a safe city or a city with less criminality with only police. I don't believe that police should be a social worker, but I strongly believe that we need a lot of social workers, a lot of youth workers. So, and they have to work together, but they have both their own role and their own place in society. So we invested a lot in police, but we also invested a lot in youth working. And one of the successful projects was, and it were out of the box projects, as I told you, was the Big Brother and Big Sister project. So we gave the opportunity to young people in Mechelen as a job student to work for the city during holidays. And they were situated at, for example, a basketball field or a football field or a small parking town where youngsters, young people hang around. And they controlled it a little bit. Their job was to keep an eye on those youngsters, that they did not fight, that they didn't break down the place, that there was no vandalism, that they didn't that they weren't aggressive to people who passed by, that they respected, let's say, the rules of a town, that at 10 o'clock you start being more quiet because people have to sleep. And those young people, and we did it already, we do it for 20 years already, in 20, 30, 40 every year, at every place they were there, and they were considered a little bit as the big brother and the big sister. So there was a kind of social control. And for them, it was also very interesting. A lot of them tell me now they are themselves father and mother already, 15 years later. They said, the first time I was thinking about the importance of rules like be quiet at 10 o'clock, respect other people, don't break down that playground, it's your playground, was the moment I got the responsibility of the city to play a role for the city at such a playground. And that was the moment I start thinking as a citizen. I start thinking out of a context of responsibility. And for me, it was a very important growing process. So it was a win-win. They won, but also the kids that played there, sometimes a few years younger, for the first time, they saw the city not as a policeman coming there with a car because somebody had phoned that there was a problem, sometimes a little bit aggressive. No, they saw that the city, it was their nephew. It was the boy from their street who grew up with them, or somebody from around the corner. And he represented the city, and he spoke to them in the name of the city. So for them, it was also more easy to identify themselves with the city and being a citizen. So this is one of the successful, durable programs we already have in Mechelen for nearly 20 years. And at this moment, I can say hundreds of young people in Mechelen have been in that program, have contributed in a positive way to the livability of a city, and they played a very important role. Of course, when something went really wrong, they contacted the police, then the police has to come. But for those small and minor incidents that irritate people, they were a good answer. Next. So maybe I can give you, before I go to the second thing, two other examples, because we did so many different things. For example, we had a problem with pizza delivery boys. You know them in every city. They have a kind of a small motor. They drive around. They drive over pavements. They drive everywhere. They don't respect rules. They are rather aggressive, make a lot of noise, and people are very irritated by it. They say that it gives me a feeling of uneasiness, of it breaks in my feeling of feeling safe, and they drive aggressively, and it's dangerous with my small kid walking on the street, and there will some maybe there will happen something. What did we do? We thought of an out-of-the-box solution, because it's maybe you see it as a minor problem, but at a certain moment the mayor gets a lot of telephones about it, and you have a lot of delivery boys today. We said, okay, you have to pay a tax for every moto. If you have a pizzeria, for example, or a pita bar, and for every moto, you pay a tax of, let's say, 500 euros a year, a very high tax. But if you change the moto with a bike, we subsidize the bike. So the idea was, we try to use taxes to make a shift from moto to bike. So we support those pizzerias and pita bars and other delivery businesses by subsidizing their bikes, but by punishing with taxes their motos. And it's a completely different situation, because now those young guys drive with bikes. That's never so as aggressive. It's not noisy. It gives another atmosphere in town. It's sympathetic, it's healthy, everybody wins, and it resolves a small irritation in town. And we did that with a lot of things. For example, with night shops, last example, we made a kind of contract with those night shops. They have to pay very high taxes, city taxes. Let's say, out of my head, a few thousand euros a year. But you can get a subsidy of the same amount of money, so that in fact you don't have to pay, if you sign a contract with the city. And in that contract, it's a few rules. You have to keep the environment around your shop clean, 30 meters around it. You have to be part of an organization of the businessmen of your street, so that you integrate yourself a little bit in the economic and social life, a few rules, and people respect that, because the control is, if you don't break, if you break the contract, you don't get a subsidy, and then you have to pay the tax. So it's again a kind of fiscal instrument we use, not to punish people, but to help them to be a positive element in town. And It works. It's a system that already exists for 15 years also in Mechelen, and it creates a completely other atmosphere around night shops. Night shops are sometimes, for example, one of the rules is also you may not sell alcohol to minors younger than 16 years. So that's an element in that contract we make with those night shops. And we did a lot of those things to get an atmosphere in town. Second thing we did is the public domain. For me, the public domain, it's a very important thing. It's, for me, the big equalizer in town. Because in the public domain, it's from everybody. In a city, you have poor people and rich people, but the public domain belongs to everybody. So people experience also the public domain as a sort of respect for them. If your public domain is demolished, filthy, not interesting, people will not feel motivated to do something there. So what we try to do is to create a nice public domain, not only in the city center, especially in the poorer and more vulnerable neighborhoods. And we don't use other materials there than in the center of town, because I see sometimes in cities that they clean up their city center, and if you go back to the more, let's say, poorer neighborhoods or the outside neighborhoods, you see that they often use less materials with less quality, and it's a signal you give to people. For example, you know those boxes, those basketball boxes with metal bars, like you see in American movies in prisons. It gives you a feeling, and then you are looking for material that cannot be destroyed. Yeah, that's nearly an invitation for people to behave in another way, and it gives also a signal that we don't trust you. You are different. You are not as important as those people living in middle class neighborhoods or in the city center. So what we try to do is create a public domain with the same quality. Of course, there is still a lot of work to do. You cannot do that overnight. But we try to invest a lot in the quality of the public domain. I can give you a photo. That's the next slide. So Mechelen was like that, let's say, 20 years ago. And the next picture, the next one, that's the same street now with the open water. And I can show you, so a lot of you have to come to Mechelen to see it yourself. You will experience the city as a very clean and nice and a beautiful town, especially the public domain. And we did the same also in our social neighborhoods. It's a good example. This is a social housing from the 70s. This is how it is today. It's the same thing. We broke it down and we rebuilt it in a much more nice and with a lot more quality, in a much more human scale, with respect. If you drive through our social neighborhoods, you will not be able to say this is a social neighborhood. It is exactly the same atmosphere, the same quality as the rest of town. For us, it was a very important thing. We invested a lot of money in it, because that's also a kind of respect for people. Last example, small project. That's what we are doing on a very vast scale. I think we invested the past 20 years more than 400 million euros in social housing alone. So for us, that was a very important thing. A second element in the public domain, that's the next picture, that is that we invested in a very child-friendly atmosphere. And what was the idea behind that? It was also a kind of psychological idea, because we were the most criminal town 20 years ago. We had a real issue with criminality. People didn't like to come to Mechelen in Flanders because they say that there's too much criminality. And I was communicating all the time that criminality rates are going down, that we invested a lot in police, that there's a lot of cameras, that there was a lot of prevention workers. But every time I communicated about criminality in a positive way, I was speaking about criminality and Mechelen. It was always the link. That's like saying there is no elephant in the room. Then everybody is thinking about an elephant. So when I was saying criminality is not a problem anymore, everybody says, yeah, Mechelen and criminality, it's a problem. So we say we need to find another way, another approach. And one of the elements we thought about was why don't we make Mechelen as a child-friendly city? Because if a city is child-friendly, it's a safe city. A city cannot be child-friendly and dangerous at the same time. So, and we had a few assets for doing that. We have a big zoo, Plankendaal. We have a Speelgoed Museum, a toy museum, rather famous in Flanders. So we had a few objective elements that could be used in that image building of a child-friendly town. But we created a lot of play elements in city. This is Opsenjörg, is a symbol of Mechelen, a very big one, where people can play near the cathedral, young people can play there. So we brought that also in town. So if you come to Mechelen, you will see it. It's a lot of child-friendly things we created to create another atmosphere. Next. That's another example. For 3 weeks, we make a beach on our central marketplace in the historical town. And it started with volleyball matches between the different businesses in Mechelen, the different factories who make teams and play with each other. And then for 14 days, it's a kind of beach in Mechelen to create that more agreeable, that nicer atmosphere. At the moment, it's not necessary anymore because Mechelen is seen at the moment as a very nice and friendly town, but it took time to create that kind of image of Mechelen. Next one. What we also did was, next slide, we also invested a lot in parks. We created a lot of public parks. In a lot of neighborhoods, we created public parks because we believe that these are places where people can meet each other, can speak with each other. We invested also in people, volunteers who help to keep the city clean. We call it also... It's a project. 200 people in Mechelen help us to, as volunteers, to keep the city also clean, and it creates a kind of engagement to town. And some parks are, this is what we call the quiet park. You may not play there. It's for people to be very calm. Other parks are real playing parks. So we try to create a different kind of green spots in town. And I think at the moment we have created already nearly 15 new parks. Sometimes mini parks, sometimes rather big parks in town. And then next one. For us was also important because what's the problem with the city that has a negative reputation is people don't want to engage in that city. People are angry because the city is dirty, the city is unsafe. And people try to find for themselves who is responsible for what's happening in my town. Who is responsible for the negative things I see every day in town. And then you open the door for two things. People are very angry at City Hall. Those politicians, they cannot do anything right. So they look for more extreme alternatives. And that's, of course, an easy situation for an extreme right political party as Vlaams Belang to gain votes. If the city is dirty, is unsafe, people lock themselves up in their house and they are angry at the politicians who do the thing or do not the right thing. So we vote for somebody else, extremists. And secondly, you are also angry at the others. Go back maybe, the slide. Yeah, they are also angry at other people. And who are the other people? Of course, there are people with another cultural background. They are angry at immigrants because they are responsible for everything that goes wrong. They don't know them. They don't want to speak with them. They don't want to get involved in anything. They are angry at the city. People close their door, stay in, and they don't want to be volunteer or do something positive. When I started as a mayor, we had zero street parties, zero. Zero street, organizations, maybe not zero, two or three, to be honest, two or three. At the moment, we have more than 100, and it grew every year, and we invest in it. If you want to do a barbecue in your street, we pay the meat for the barbecue. We deliver the barbecue set, so we support that because that are small moments where people learn to know each other. And that's important because if there is a small problem in the street, they will not telephone the police anymore. They will ring at the door and they will speak with each other because they know each other from the party, the place where they met. And it creates also an interaction in a positive way because people start thinking, what can we do in our street to make it better? Sometimes they come complain at City Hall. It's not always easy for a mayor, but because people become more outspoken, but people get engaged again. They get engaged. They feel citizen again. In a city where there is more safety, a city that's more clean, they want to do something back for the town. And so we created a lot of those neighborhood communities. And the last thing where we invested in, another last, yeah, next slide. Also in our public, public meeting places, cultural meeting places and so on, we invested a lot. For example, our library, if you ever come to Mechelen, you have to go to the library. It's an old monastery of the 17th century. It's beautifully renovated. It's really an iconic place because we believe that, for example, a library is a place where people meet. A lot of students come to study there, often students who don't have the possibility to study at home. And it's always, it's also a form of respect for everybody in town. So that's something we also believe that's part of the what we see the public domain. And then the last thing we did, that is we tried to create, this is the Holocaust Museum. You know that in Mechelen, Caserne de Rossin was the place where the Nazis brought all the Jews and Gypsies together, the Tsigan people together, before they exterminated them in, they killed them, in murdered them in Auschwitz. So it's a very sad page in our history. So the Flemish government created a very important museum for Holocaust and human rights. And we invested as a city in this thing. We want to make it a kind of DNA of Mechelen. We want to be a just city, a city of justice, a city that respects human rights. And one of the biggest successes I think we had was at the moment that there was a refugee crisis. There at that moment, the government asked a lot of cities, can you open in your city also a refugee center? And most of the mayors in Flanders, I speak about Flanders, said, no, we don't want that because that's a problem. And we said, as a city council, we demand the right to have a refugee center because we think it's our duty out of our history of the Holocaust, out also of the history of the First World War. We had a lot of refugees in Mechelen living abroad. We want to do it. We demand the right to have one and still have one in the city center. And there was zero protest. Nobody protested. That in a city, 15 years before, 30% voted extreme right and voted France Blanc. Nobody protested. So that was for me a moral victory. That's the, for me, the highlight of the moral, let's say, change over of a city, that you are capable of creating a completely other, let's say, perception of who we are and what we stand for in 15 years time. And a second element in that was at the moment that a lot of people went to Syria to fight there, we were the only city in Flanders where nobody left to fight in Syria. We can say that we protected our kids from out of the extremists, the hands of the extremists. And that is only possible, that's my deepest conviction, if people can see themselves as one, as first class citizens of a city. That you live in a city with not first and second class people, but that everybody feels part of the town, part of the community. Because if you see yourself as a citizen, you will not attack the city that's part of, you will not attack the society where you're part of. So that's the second pillar, maybe with last image, the last, yeah, next one. That's the propaganda photo of Maidan. That third pillar, and the third thing is, we try to fight segregation and try to create a living together. And for me, that's also a very important thing, where we have a very own philosophy. And what is my philosophy? I think the three things you have to create is, you have to fight segregation. You have to, secondly, create an inclusive citizenship. And the third of all, you have to create equal opportunities. So fight racism, invest in social mobility. Those three things are very important. Fighting segregation, create inclusive citizenship, and create equal opportunities. That's the, for me, the most important thing, to create a city, a positive city in diversity. Next movie, next slide, sorry. I wait for the slide to come. Hello. Next slide. I cannot manage it myself, so I hope that somebody hears me now and goes to the next slide. I can maybe start telling them about it, maybe it's blocked, but what about segregation? I think A lot of people, progressive people, speak about, they will come back. So a lot of people, a lot of progressive people, and I count myself as a progressive politician, speak about diversity as something positive. But how many people with the other ethnic cultural background we really know in our daily life? Often not so much. A city is often an archipelago of monocultural islands. We live often in closed societies, closed communities, not together but apart from each other, mentally or physically. And if you have a city that exists out of a kind of archipel of monocultural islands, that's a very dangerous basis for misunderstandings, for jealousy, for discussions, for polarization, because people will say, why do they get a new playground and we don't get a new playground in our neighborhood? Why is the police always controlling in our neighborhood and not in their neighborhood? So what I try to do is go away from a city of communities and go to a city of citizens, accepting that everybody has different identities, that everybody has to be proud of those different identities, but that those identities, you define for yourself those identities. But it's very important that people in a city have also contact, real contact, with people with another background. Then diversity has an added value because it broadens your perspective, it interrogates your own ideas, it challenges you in a positive way, and you overcome misunderstandings and wrong ideas of people with another background. So one of the programs we made for that was a kind of buddy project. Every newcomer in Mechelen gets a buddy. So that's somebody of the city of Mechelen who is linked to that newcomer. And it's part of, let's say, the integration process of somebody. He has to learn the language, okay, and he has to find work, but he also has to get connected with society. And so we bring those people together in a kind of speed dating program, because we look for people of the same age, the same background, intellectual background and so on. And they spend 40 hours together. Every week, 2 hours, they walk to town. For the newcomer, he can practice the language because he has to learn Dutch, but he has nobody to speak it with. So he can practice the language. The citizen of Mechelen can explain the town, how it works, the normal things, that you don't have to be afraid of police in our society, that when a man and a woman kisses each other on the street, it's just for saying hello. It's nothing more than that. It's a greeting. He can explain what a parent has to do when his kid is at school and following lessons, courses, what the parents is expected to do in our society. So he can give a lot of information. And we found a lot of volunteers, and not only, let's say, people are very open for multiculturality, but also people are, let's say, more conservative, more strict. And they said, I want to show them how our society functions and works. But the strange thing is that whatever your intentions are, after 3-4 weeks, those people become friends. They become close to each other. They tell personal things to each other. And even after the course, we invited them to City Hall and gave them a kind of diploma and a reception to thank them. They stay in close contact. And it's very important for the newcomer, because the University of Leuven has examined that if somebody with an ethnical background, with a foreign ethnical cultural background, has in his direct environment, in his social circle, only one person with another ethnic cultural background, his opportunities in the labor market and the housing market double. They become twice as big. So it gives him more opportunities for social mobility. And at the same time, for the citizen of Mechelen, it's also interesting, because often it's the first time in his life that invites somebody with another ethnic cultural background in his house, in his where he lives, with his family, at his table. And in his way of thinking about diversity changes completely. And also the newcomer, his idea of our society, he gets a much deeper, a much better idea of how our society really functions. You cannot learn that in a classroom. You learn that only by social contacts. So we created that program. Secondly, what we did is that we try to get much more mixed schools. We have a program for that school in Zicht. We convinced in 3 years' time 250 parents voluntarily to change school, to go with their middle-class white kids to the neighborhood school, even if it is what we call in Dutch a concentration school, a school with a high concentration of migrant kids. We could convince them to do that because we want to have mixed schools. We do the same with the whites. We also think that white ghettos are also not good in town. So we also try to convince migrant parents to send their kids to the, let's say, the elite schools in our town. And that also works. And the last thing, the following thing, but I am sorry that I cannot see. Can you see the program already? The slides? No?
Yes, you can see the slide.
I cannot see them anymore. So that's a little bit strange. So I don't know which slide we are. One moment. I try to. No.
You don't see the slide?
No, I don't see the slides. So I have to trust that my people follow me. So I hope that the next thing we did was a program, Square Makers, it's called Plan Makers. What did we do? In our social neighborhoods, we saw that there were a lot of social problems, like in every social neighborhood. Poor people live together, unemployed people live together, people with not enough possibilities in life live together in those bigger social neighborhoods. What did we do? We 1%, only 1% of the social houses, we rent to people at a low price, 300 euros, like the price you have to pay if you are a social renter. For people who have more income than that, but are prepared to take up a social role in that neighborhood for 20 hours, for 8 hours a week. They have to support the neighborhood by, for example, by explaining to the people who live there what to do with your garbage, to help them understand the system of selecting garbage and do it in the right way better. Secondly, by helping the kids with their homework. Third, giving lessons in Dutch for those who need it. Fourth, organize a festival in that neighborhood so that people can meet each other and learn to know each other. A lot of things they do, they play a little bit the role of social worker, and they are not paid by the town, but they are paid because they get a low rent and a house for maximum 3 years. So it's a kind of also creating there a kind of social economic mix and also a mix of opportunities. And it gives another perspective in those social neighborhoods. And you have, that's one of the ideas the Flemish government will do now everywhere. In every city can start with a program like that. And also there, I have to tell that we also invested a lot in normalizing, let's say, relations in town. For example, you see a picture, I hope you see it, of an iftar organized at the marketplace in Mechelen. People say now he's getting crazy, that our mayor, why does he, is he converted to Islam? But I try to explain that we have a Catholic procession for hundreds of years already in our town, and every year it goes through town. It's a kind of historical evocation of Christianity in Mechelen, and we are very proud of it. But we also have to be proud of those citizens of Mechelen who are Muslims, because they are an irreversible and a very as important part of our town, of who we are. So we said we have to also not hide it, but show it to everybody and be proud of it, be proud of the diversity, and don't problemize everything. So we organized the iftar a few times. The next picture is, we have a tradition of giants. You also have it, I think, in Wallonia in some cities, those historical medieval giants. It was a family of four. We already have it for 500 years. Everybody in Mechelen is proud of it. It's a father, a mother, and two kids. Now we have two more Noah en Amir. Noah is a Black African and Amir is a North African citizen of Mechelen, and the family has grown. So we bring it also in the symbols of our town, that diversity is not a problem, but something we are very proud of. So that's because it's already 8 o'clock, 7 o'clock, sorry. I think that's the important thing of what I had to say about Mechelen, those three pillars. Maybe I can very fast go through my new role, and it only takes 3 minutes. And that's my role now as Vice Minister President, responsible for integration, living together, and also local authorities. So let's say a little bit the mayor now of Flanders, if I may say it a little bit like that. What did we pick out of the Mechelen project or the Mechelen approach in the Flemish, let's say, new coalition? That's in our integration policy, we will bring in the fourth pillar, the buddy project, as something we roll out in the whole of Flanders. So every newcomer in Flanders will have a buddy for 40 hours where he can be attached to it, and that gives him, let's say, a better and stronger network in Flanders. Second thing, what we try to do is to strengthen the role of local government. We think that it's my conviction that the local governments are the governments of the future. They have the best possibilities to make a change in society, and they have to be strengthened. And if you see, there's the next slide, that in Flanders only 13% of the money of the government is spent by local authorities. In the Netherlands, it's 30%, and in Denmark, it's 65%. So we still have a long way to go before our cities and communities have the same power and the same responsibilities as cities in the Netherlands or even in Denmark. So we try to, let's say, create an internal staatshervorming, an internal, let's say, reconstruction of Flanders by putting more power and more responsibilities to the local level. And we also invested more in cities. Last government between 2014 and 2019, 15 billion euros went to the local authorities. This legislation, it will be 20 billion. So it has grown very, very fast. And I would like to end with somebody I respect a lot, that Benjamin Barber, If Mayors Rule the World, but also with Rahm, was the mayor of Chicago, who wrote a very interesting book, The Nation City, because they both explain why cities are the solution for a lot of our challenges. And it has to do with the fact that the mayor and a city works always horizontally. It can integrate a lot of elements in its policy. He's much more pragmatic. He has to find solutions. He cannot afford himself to discuss for months, like in parliament, about issues. If the street is broken, he has to repair it. He cannot discuss for months how he will repair it and who it will repair it. He has to do it. And you also see that in a lot of governments, situations are often blocked. We don't find real answers anymore to the challenges of today and tomorrow. And you see that the answers often come from cities, from local authorities. They find solutions for the challenges of today and tomorrow. And if you speak about living together, which is a very big challenge, and certainly also in Flanders, because there's a lot of first about it, contestation, I think integration happens in cities. Social mobility will happen in cities, or it will not happen. So I strongly believe that cities can find positive answers. And I think that Mechelen in a very small way shows that even if you sit in a difficult situation, you can change it very fast, and you can create a completely different atmosphere in a town and a completely different situation. So I thank you for listening to me, and maybe there are still questions or discussion about what I told. Thanks.